the bottom line is, cravings are cultural. We're going to crave what we've been exposed to. We cannot villainize the fact that humans have crazy cravings or we're driven to eat certain things. We've always wanted to seek out stuff that tastes good. That's what makes us want to eat it. But with that being said, we now exist in a culture to where we're craving things that aren't even real food anymore, right? 60% of the average American adult's diet is ultra-processed food. This is published in the BMJ. But with the Eat Smarter Family Cookbook, this is the first book that's detailing this recently published study published in JAMA looking at our kids' intake of ultra-processed food. And this was a 20-year study. The researchers found that in 1999, the average American child's diet was made of 61% ultra-processed food. By 2018, it was almost 70% of our children's diet is now made of ultra-processed fake food. And so these are the things that we're craving now as a culture, whereas people in that hunter-gatherer tribe would have cravings and a drive towards eating real food, right? Natural fruits, vegetables, nuts and seeds, animal products, things that they've been exposed to that we evolved eating. And so we're dealing with a different culture scape right now. But what this mission is really about is taking the power back into our hands and creating a microculture in our own home that makes healthy choices automatic.
How do we do that? What are some of the biggest obstacles you think for creating a culture, a healthy culture within our homes? What are they and how do we circumvent that?
That's such a great question. For me, one of the most important things with any kind of success is removing the obstacle, right? It's the same paradigm with treatment. Again, treating the symptom instead of the root cause. Let's remove the cause so that it makes this process so much easier. So one of the things preventing us from leveraging this is we no longer intentionally, for most of us, most families, unfortunately, myself included, we're not proactively creating a culture of wellness. We're a product of our environment, absolutely, but we're also creators of our environment if we become aware of it. So for me, I was just a product of my environment growing up in the inner city, growing up in poverty, in a condition where we would get food from charities, you know, we were on government assistance programs, all these things. Most of our diet, we're inundated, we're surrounded by ultra-processed food. I didn't know that there was a difference. And by the way, just so we have a distinction on what the difference is, let's clear this up because humans—
Please, yes, please.
Humans have been processing foods forever, all right? If you cook a food, that is processing that food. And, you know, whether we're taking a yam and baking it or cooking meat or taking an olive and pressing the oil out, that is a process. With that being said, humans have been doing that a long time. As a matter of fact, one of the foods that I pointed out in the new cookbook, and by the way, there's over 250 scientific references.
I could not believe it. I could not believe how well done this book is.
Thank you. This is a paradigm shifter because that amount of science has never been put into a cookbook before, let alone laid out in a fun way, in a beautiful way, and a way that is empowering for everybody.
Very
at the same
user-friendly.
Time.
It's so user-friendly.
So one of these foods that I targeted in the book, I identified over 40 specific foods that have mind-blowing benefits that are seen in high quality peer reviewed data. One of those foods is olive oil. And olives are historic. They're mentioned in books for centuries. There's something really special about that fruit. It's a fruit. And that particular oil, this oleocanthal rich substance that should be bottled in dark glass. We naturally do that. We've done that for centuries as well. Our ancestors knew there's something really special about this oil, but it's sensitive. It's even sensitive to light as well. So bottled in dark glass, extra virgin means that it's cold temperature processed. So it's not heat treated. And traditionally it's a stone pressing. And what these researchers at Auburn University found was that this food is one of the few foods ever discovered that has the potential to repair the blood-brain barrier after damage. And what they found was that this food can help to reduce neural inflammation, which is a huge problem right now that's not being talked about.
Yeah.
In particular, and this is from researchers at Albert Einstein College of Medicine, they found that hypothalamic inflammation, so the HPA axis. This is the tip of the spear.
Yeah.
Largely can be considered a master gland, if not the master gland in the body. It's the integration point of our endocrine system and our nervous system. And it's really setting, I like to think of it as the thermostat for your metabolism, right? It's right. The thyroid is along that super highway, the HPA axis. Your gonads are right, or your adrenals, all the things. But they found that hypothalamic inflammation is directly leading to increased levels of downstream belly fat and insulin resistance. And they found that excessive belly fat and insulin resistance was creating more inflammation in the brain. And this is happening. This vicious circle is getting created. And a lot of people, we're not talking about addressing the inflammation in your brain to help downstream with losing body fat. And in particular, of course, with gaining muscle, by the way.
Yeah, of course. When talking with you. The listeners know, yes.
And so the last little piece of this is olive oil has the potential to reduce inflammation in the brain, helping those downstream outcomes that we want to change. And that's really, really special. So, but also, okay, you know about these great benefits.
We'd have a question about olive oil. Olive oil have, can it be heated or it's not heated, right? You keep it cold pressed. If you heat it, will it destroy any of those low molecular weight molecules?
It's a great question. And we've got to understand, yes, when we heat anything, it's going to change the chemistry. Absolutely. But it is relatively stable to a certain degree. You know, we talk about things like the smoke point and all this stuff. Personally, I would not utilize olive oil as my primary cooking oil, but you can cook with it and it's okay. You're still going to be able to extract a lot of benefits.
What would be your primary?
Something that is more stable, higher in saturated fat. So ghee, grass-fed butter, coconut oil, tallow, things like that. Mm.